Hello everyone, welcome to my stream. Another Friday, another Amiga OS stream. I'm George, you can find me as Walkero on various Amiga forums. Welcome, I see we have today Livelord. Welcome Livelord to the stream. Welcome another TV viewer. How are you doing, guys? I hope that today's stream is going to be interesting for you as well. And we are going to dive into Amiga OS 4.1 again, and that's what we are going to discuss today. How are you doing, everyone? Today we are going to start investigating again the file system of Amiga OS 4.1, as we did on the previous stream, so that we get more familiar with the system and how it works and where things are. Okay, and let me first stop the music. And later we are going to see how you are using applications to connect with the internet and get information or visit websites or listen music or whatever. So let's not waste any more time, and let's open my installation. I hope you see clear my desktop, and it is fine, and the sound is good. If not, please tell me on the chat how you can hear me. So the last time, the last two streams, we discussed about the press folder and the system folder. Today I would like to show you the utilities, and also we already discussed about the emulation folder, right? Where on the previous stream, where we saw how you can play classic Amiga games and demos on the Amiga OS 4.1. Today we are going to start investigating the utilities, which is, if you remember, we on the previous streams we said that tools and utilities that we have on Amiga OS 3 both are merged into utilities, so you don't have any tools folder, but everything is in utilities. And we have various different applications here. From the top, we have AmiGS and AmiPDF. Those are applications that can be used to open PostScript and PDF files. For example, here, let me open something from my hard disk. And it shows the PDF that you open, and of course you can do it also by double clicking the icon, because this specific viewer, this specific application is the default tool, right? So that's how you can read PDF files on Amiga OS 4.1 with AmiPDF. And let's open something that's vertical, maybe. Let me check here. A PDF with different sections, so you can jump to the section by clicking on the menu at the left. And let me zoom like that. And here you have the PDF viewer working on your system. The AmiGS is looking similar. It's an application that is used to open PostScript files usually. Let me see if I have something to. So you can use it to open PS, PostScript files, and EPS, and PDF as well. The next one is Prefs Objects Editor. This is an application that helps you manage configuration files that were created by different applications. I think one of them is AmiDog. Those files usually save the prefs in XML format. Let me see on NVARC if we can find something. So if I go to sys, AmiDog, here it is. It opens a tree analyzed file that has all the information from the XML and shows you all the options that you have, and you can go here and change something. For example, if you want this value to be more than 60, you can change it at the bottom and save it. And this is an easy way to edit XML configuration files. Hello, Livelord. Welcome to the stream. And that's what this prefs object editor does. The next one is directory opus 4. As I said on previous stream, the CD-ROM that you get for the Amiga OS 4.1, it has some contributed applications in there, which are optional to install if you want. One of them is directory opus 4, which works fine here. It is Amiga OS 4 native application, so you know directory opus 4, how it looks and how it works. It is pretty fast, of course, and yeah, it is compiled for Amiga OS 4 and for the PowerPC CPUs that are used by the Amiga ones. Next one is Icon Edit, which is pretty similar like the one that we had on previous versions of Amiga OS, like Amiga OS 3. Currently it is not used anymore because it is quite old and it doesn't support the PNG icons, so it is an application that probably you are not going to use at all with Amiga OS 4.1. One other application that is available as in the contribution is Ranger, and that application shows information about the hardware and the software that runs currently on your system. Livelord says directory opus for the best file manager. Exactly, yeah, it's the best file manager across all operating systems. yeah, so you can see here that the characteristics of this machine is an Amiga One X5000. It has information about the bus and the memory size that it supports, the graphics card, and information about the U-boot, the firmware that is loaded whenever you open, you start your machine. The different tasks that are currently running, libraries that are currently open, and it has an analysis of whatever is running right now on your computer, which is, yeah, here are all the applications that are running, so you can go and see the reaction workbench info, some information for that, and even you can send some signals, so you can send control C to close the application if you want. The devices, the volumes, the different volumes of your system and information about them, the different assigns that you might have on your system, and a lot of other things. Yeah, it is quite useful if you try to figure out what is running currently on your machine, and to see if something crashes, how, in case you can close it from here. Next one, CodePad, is an application that is currently on beta testing, so you are not going to have it on your system. Dokis is an interesting thing. It's we have the AmiDog at the bottom, or wherever you put it on your system, right? So you can have Dokis are some kind of modules that you can use on your AmiDoc and add some extra features, for example. Like, let me try something, this dock here. You see that this docky does some animation here with changing the colors. Of course, this specific docky is just for demonstration, doesn't do anything useful, but you see that you can do something like that in case someone wants to create something for his own Doki. There are other Dokis, for example the lens, which adds here an analysis of the it magnifies the area that you are looking and shows the pixels, for example like that here. And if you go wherever you go, you can see how it looks from a closer look. I don't know. Yeah, if you click, it becomes bigger. So it's something like a magnifier. Let me close that. And as well, the rest are, you can have a clock on your AmiDoc like that. And by clicking on it, you get the time preferences. And but the thing with the Dokis are the different other Dokis that people create all the time. And there are a lot Dokis that show in real time the status of your machine. For example, the ones that I have at the top of this screen here. Let me magnify it. At the top right corner, I don't know if it is visible for you, let me like that. Yeah, if you can see, I have dokis for the CPU and the RAM, how much RAM is occupied right now, and the graphics card, the RAM of the graphics card, how much is used, the time as well, and the I have also a doki for the language, for the sound, and for the temperature on my machine. Let me show you how they are working. If I click, for example, on the CPU, I can get a list of the applications that are currently running. Let me see. Yeah, now you can see it on your screen. The applications that are running, and also a history of the CPU. How fast is it going? I mean, how fast? Sorry, how high usage of the CPU I have. So if I open an application, let's see if I open iBrowse and do some stuff here, you will see that there are going to be some spikes on the CPU usage. There is some delay on the screen that you see. Let me see if I can do something about that. Okay. I think now it's better. Yeah. So you see here some information about the CPU and the CPU workload. In a percentage, and the same can be seen with RAM and with the graphics card RAM, which is you can see how much of this is occupied by the applications and the graphics in your system. And also I have here another doki that shows the temperature and the voltages on different parts of the motherboard. Hello, Braceta. Welcome to the stream. Presenta says we had the retro computers party 2 weeks ago. Main participants got infected with COVID. Oh my god. And it resulted to cancellation of upcoming Amiga party. Good evening to everyone. Oh my god, Presenta, I hope that they are feeling better right now. That's bad. Yeah, Livelord, it's horrible. I hope our special guest is okay. It was David Pleasance. Yeah, I hope so. I hope everyone is going to be okay, to be honest. Livelord asks, language doc, is it the system or from OS40pod? You can find it on OS40pod, yeah. It's the one that you can use to switch between different keyboard layouts, and you can assign also a shortcut on your keyboard to do it on the fly. Yeah, Presenta, I hope that everyone is going to be fine. And yeah, it's the thing right now with the whole situation that we need to see more people, but we feel more secure because we are vaccinated, but it seems that's not the case, unfortunately. And that's something that I'm thinking a lot about, the upcoming event that's going to happen on January, at the end of January, here in Ireland, about Amiga, and I'm curious to see how it will go. Yeah, Livelord, it's very, very interesting docky, because you can assign a second key layout. You have the main one, which is configured by the preferences and locale. No, sorry, not locale. Where is it? Oh my god, I forgot about it. It's for the input. Yeah, here. Input. You can select the one that is your main one, and that's the same one here that it show, it is shown on the configuration of this docky for the language. And then you can set an alternative one, and at the bottom you can set which is going to be the shortcut that you are going to use on your keyboard. And also here I have a docky that shows the network activity on my system. Yeah. So yeah, with that, as you can see this, the top right corner, I have all these dockies. But actually what I have there is an AmiDock, like the one that I have at the bottom. It's the same thing, but it is filled with dockies. So if I click here and do an edit, you will see that I have a new docky created at here, and it is named as top bars, and I have all the dockies there. So, and also I set it to be icons to be locked in that place, and to be transparent, fully transparent, so you can show that at that position. And also the nice with this docky about the date is that if you click it, it opens a small calendar at that side, at the top right corner for me at least. And from there you can click on time prefs if you want to open time prefs and change something, synchronize the date or anything you want to do, or even if you want just to check the date, okay, like you do on more on other systems as well. So that's what dockies are. There are a lot of other dockies available on OS4 depot. And also for me, if you see at the bottom, the AmiDock at the bottom, if I click, for example, this icon, it opens another AmiDock, and that's something that you can do with AmiDoc. It has that ability for AmigaOS 4, but also you can use a smart subdoc, which is doing pretty much the same, but in a better way. In case you move the AmiDoc to somewhere else, it moves as well the subdocs. Subdocs are the docs, the AmiDocs that are opening from other items on the dock. That's what dockies are. We have file compare. This is quite useful, especially if you want to compare some files to see if there are any differences. I use it a lot whenever I work on translations to see if there are new strings and I need to test them. Let me see if I have something to show you about that. Something fast. For example, I'm going to open something here. This file and something else, quite different. Okay, and it opens with both applications, one to the left, one to the right, and you see all the differences. As you can see, the NDIF at the end is similar, so it is on a white background, and the others are on different color. And at the bottom, you can see the differences of these two strings. This is also useful if you use another application that is called Compare This from OS 4 Depot, which compares two directories, and if there are differences and you double click on a file that is different, it opens you the file compare like I showed you, and you see exactly the differences of these files. Preseda says this is far beyond me. I never got far than OS 3, but looks nice. Thank you, Preseda. Thank you very much. You didn't have any previous experience with AmigaOS 4. You at the events that you go, no one has any AmigaOS 4, and you didn't have any chance to sit on his seat and try it out. Livelot says that is Ubuntu font in your system. I'm sure of it. Yeah, I have Ubuntu font on my system at some places. Yeah, I do that. Blankers. The blankers, we have seen the preferences for the blankers, which is here. Those are the modules that are loaded on the preferences of the screen blanker, and is exactly that. It shows a blank a blanker whenever the screen is disabled after some time of not being used. There are a lot of blankers on OS 4 Depot which you can test. And yeah, because they are like modules, you drop them here on blankers folder, and then they are automatically loaded on the preferences, and you enable whichever you like. Preseda says, as you say, I have seen the system several times but never tried. You afraid that you are going to be amazed and you are going to want to buy one, like right? Little says it looks very nice. I have installed it under my AmigaOS 3 thanks to AlphaOS. Looks really good. The Ubuntu font, yeah, it is very clear. I like it a lot. Although that I don't use Ubuntu anymore for a long time on my main system, the main work system that I use, it is based on Manjaro, so. The default fonts there are not Ubuntu, of course, and yeah, but I like to use it here. And also, I like to use it here because it is clear when you use the Wordsworth and the Final Writer. It is a very nice font to use it there. Next is the calculator, which is a calculator, but it has also the extended mode if you want to do some extra things, and also some calculations for hexadecimal or decimal numbers, which is also useful for development. Then we have the classic multi-view. Let me see here, if you open a picture like that, it opens the picture, of course, and it also can be used to listen to music for whatever file it is supported on data with data types. Okay, so if you have a mod file and you open it here, if you have the data types, then it will play the mod file. Clock is the classic clock, but it is PPC native application, so it runs super fast. And also you have the digital clock here, and you can also set some alarms if you want to. It's pretty basic, and it does the work that it needs to be done. Installation utility. This is an interesting application, because but if you try to run it, you can't do anything with that. This is an application that is used by Python code. Hello, Falcon 11. Welcome to the stream. Welcome. It's like, think about it like the installer we have for all the installations procedures that we use for all the applications, but this is used with Python. Let me see if I have something to show you. Yeah, if you ever had the chance to try the AmigaOS updates, AmigaOS 4 updates, let's see here, yeah, the installation, if you double click, let me select here, this window that has the image at the top and the next steps and all of that, this window uses the installation utility. This tool is written on Python, Python 2.5, and the installation utility is used to translate the code that is created to a nice UI for the users to use, and try to help them step by step to finish the steps that need to be done. Next one is the key show, which shows the keys on your keyboard, and if you click the control, you can see on your keyboard layout what you are going to get. For example, with a shift you are going to get a capitalize, with Amiga with Alt you are going to get these characters. Quite useful, although that I would like this to be also use like a screen keyboard, because if any time we see AmigaOS 4 moved to tablets, this is going to be useful. Maybe some dreams here. Okay, what happened? Okay, something crashed my system. Let me have the first reboot and some time to discuss with you. How are you doing, Falcon 11? All good? So, yeah, the AmigaOS 4.1 is going to, trying to remember what I want to say. Sorry. Yeah, what we are going to see later after this folder, the utilities folder, we are going to see applications that use that can be used with Ethernet, and we are also going to see how you visit websites and also how you view, how you watch videos from YouTube. So bear with me, it's going to be fun. Yeah, Falcon 11. Please ask at the chat. I hope it will be ported to x86 or ARM, but tablets not much use. Yeah. I have a tablet here, Livelord, which is the first iPad I ever released, the first iPad. And yeah, I use it only for PDF files, magazines, electronic magazines that I buy, and only for this stuff. Preseta says, does IMP work for you these days? May cannot connect to the server. I tried it earlier, a few minutes ago. Where is it? IMP. Yeah, it seems to work just fine. Yeah, it works fine. I saw some complaints on EAB about IMP, and yeah, something weird is happening there. It updated to daily Livelord. Okay, that's good. So let's continue with the utilities folder. We have GhostScript here. This is an application that can be used to open and translate PostScript files. This is also useful for printing to GhostScript printers that support GhostScript. It is, as much as I know, a protocol on talking with the printer so that you can get a very good printout. Falcon 11 asks if exists some utility or tool which have an auto install, can it install with AMI update utility? The applications that have a script, auto install script, usually they are updated by AMI update utility. That's the file that the AMI update utility executes when downloads and extracts the updated version of this application. Preseta, the IMP updates itself, so you don't need to download something, but I saw on the EAB that someone proposed to download an older version from AMINET and try that again. Hello SLD Snake, welcome to the stream. Hello. No worries at all. The fun is going to happen in a few minutes. Right now we still discuss about the file system and the what you can find in utilities folder of AmigaOS 4.1. Graphic dump. If I recall right, I never use it, but if I recall right, this is an application that dumps your screenshot so that you can print it, but I might be wrong as well. Falcon 11 says, and how use this AMI update with already downloaded tool with auto install? Okay, auto install is a shell script. It has commands that are can be used on shell, right? So the only thing that you need to do is to go into that folder where you have the auto install file with your terminal, open a shell there and do execute auto install, and this is going to execute that script. Let me see if I have something to show you here. Downloads. Yeah. None. Auto install. So if you open the auto install like that, you see that it has commands that can be executed on shell. Of course, you are not going to do that manually. Okay, so if you have it on RAM, open a shell there, execute auto install, and enter. And this is going to do the rest of the things that it has to do. Some other applications might have an auto install, but after that, after you do it, it might open an installer, so you have to go step by step. That's how you can use auto install without the AMI update. Filer. The Filer is an interesting application because it started on the Open Amiga project. Someone developed it and came as a contribution to AmigaOS 4.1. It's the first try to create a file manager for AmigaOS 4.1, for AmigaOS 4, that looks like or has the feeling of the Directory Opus 5, the Magellan one. So with Filer, if you open it, you have a list. You see the files here, and you can create another list by double-clicking on that as well. And here, for example, you can set it as a destination and then select, or let me set destination the RAM and select something from here, something small, let's say ArtPass 1.2, and click here the copy, or we have move or rename and things like that, different buttons that can be also altered if you want to add your own, or you can add some of your own at the bottom, whatever you want. So if I select something here, I can do copy and it copies at the other side, and you can have multiple listers like that. It's something like what we have with Magellan, but it is developed for OS 4, and it uses, as you can see, the reaction, and it's pretty good. And also, if you remember, Magellan had a feature where you, and this feature exists, if I'm not wrong, on Morphos as well. You can double-click on the desktop and opens a list of the files. So and this is possible with this component here, FileCX, which you can, whenever you run it, I don't know if I have that. Let me set it up. So if I double click here, it opens the Filer instantly. And it also, it is useful because you can change what exactly it's going to execute. And if you want another application to be executed whenever you double click on your desktop, you can do it. Livelo says, I refuse to use Filer, looks too much as a Windows program. No, it is quite useful, to be honest, because it is fast, and you can have multiple windows with different folders, and you can copy paste from anywhere you like. I like it because it doesn't have a lot of ways to change the thing, how it works, and it is quite simple. Of course, for Amiga OS 4, there is DirectOrus Magellan ported, and someone could use that as well. Falcon 11 says, okay, it's simple, but I thought that I need to use AMI update, because if our updates downloaded with AMI update, after download, one package is executed the script. Yeah, after the package is downloaded, it executes that script. Now, I am not sure if you don't do that from AMI update, if this is going to be saved in a way so that you can do a rollback. I'm not sure. I don't think so. Presetta says, I am surprised seeing Emax. Yeah, I hated it in classic Amiga OS. There are a few applications that remain from the old times, like the icon edit, like Emax, which works just fine. It's a very good, simple simple editor, and believe me, there are developers that prefer Emax than something else. It is the editor, especially for the developers, is something that is quite based on their habits, in my opinion. Yeah, it is updated. The Emax, it is updated to run on Amiga OS 4 without problems, but of course it is an editor that it is old, and this is visible. Let me see if I can read the file. Yeah, I have to write down the path. Applications. No, I will not do that. Let me close that. Okay. Timmy here is a utility that is used for people that are using MIDI ports on Amiga OS 4. I never used that, unfortunately, because I'm not using MIDI and music instruments at all. And yeah, it is also useful because you can use it with games, especially adventures, and maybe some games like Doom, the old Doom, that use MIDI files. There is a way to use it with that as well. Falcon 11 says, this filer looks very good. Yeah, it is very good. SLD Snake says, I remember Ignacio Gulliver saying something like Emax should be at the museum. Yeah, but I had some kind of that discussion with the developers, and they don't use anything else than Emax, of course. It's Livelo says it should be, it still uses Topaz. Yeah, I think maybe there is a way to change that. Yeah, maybe not. So the Play CD is another utility that if you have a CD-ROM on your machine, which is something that is not so common anymore, unfortunately, you can play your CDs, the CD audios, audio CDs, of course. Okay, from PlayCD. It is pretty similar like the one that we have on Amiga OS 3.9. Log viewer, that's an interesting utility because it is possible with that to load log files. Those log files are saved in here in T assign. You can see those log files with an editor, but it is more convenient for anyone to see in this way. So you can see if there are errors or problems with here for the USB, here for the blanker, and for the notifications. MEMAX, we talked about that. Raw disk is a utility that can be used to get a hard disk and write it as an image file, or the opposite, and create backups, for example. Notepad is the editor, a plain editor. Okay, no color syntax, no anything. You can set the font if you want, and auto indentation, but it's a plain editor. You don't have too many features here. So config, it is an old config like the one we had on Amiga OS 3.9, 3.1.4, but not anymore with 3.2. I hope that this changes as well, because the way that 3.2 shows the information about your hardware is much better, in my opinion. ANARC, which can be used to extract archives. Falcon 11 says, you talked about Directory Opus Magellan in Morphos, but which version? Because last version is 5.92 and don't do so good. I use 5.91 OS 3. You use this version for the on the Morphos Falcon. I think that here I have the 5.92 of the Magellan. Let me see. Here it is. Yeah, 5.92, and it works pretty good. The next one is USB Inspector, which is an application that shows you information about USB flash memories or drives that you might have connected on your system, and you can click on something and get some more information. Print files, an application, a way to print. To this actually runs at the back, and you can use it to send files directly to printers. I don't use it a lot. Commodities. Commodities is like the ones that you know from Amiga OS 3. AmiDoc is a commodity. The asynchronous workbench, which runs on my workbench startup, is a commodity as well. Async workbench. This is useful whenever you copy files from a folder to another. It doesn't block your system. Yeah, the SLD Snake, the old well-known show config. Yeah, actually I don't care that much for that thing, because we have Ranger, which is, and other utilities which show the same information quite well, so there are other solutions. Falcon 11 says, yes, which version you have? 5.92. But you thought on OS 4.1 worked pretty good. Yeah, based on my experience. Let me see, if I double click, it opens here. I have the list here. All the icons are visible, as you can see. If I open something here, and then let me remember how to, OK. Okay, icons. They are visible. Yeah. It seems to work just fine. Although that I'm not that fan of Magellan, so I don't like it a lot. And also it has the problem that the desktop shows the menu of the Magellan and not the menu of the context menu of the workbench. On Morphos, I remember Falcon 11 that has some issues with icons, but I'm not sure. I don't know if this was fixed. But I remember on older versions that it had such an issue. SLD Snake says, I like that Workbench startup. It seems very efficient way to run some tools. It is very nice way to add your tools here and have a list of them and enable and disable whatever you want whenever you want. Falcon 11 says not only. This is not only the problem of the Magellan on Morphos. Possible. The guy that did the Roman Karkin Cassi, who did the port, who worked on the port, I believe he tried it more on Amiga OS4. That's why it might not have that many issues. But to be honest, since I don't use it, I prefer the Workbench. I haven't seen any specific problems with that. And also, I haven't seen any forum posts that there are problems with Magellan on OS4, but they might be hidden somewhere. Auto border size, you have seen that commodity on the latest versions of Amiga OS 3.2, which adds a way to resize the windows from every size, every corner and every side. This exists on Amiga OS 4.1 for a long time now. Auto info, this is something that you can use when you go over an icon, you get some information about that icon, especially for hard disks where you get sizes and things like that. Auto point is a commodity that whenever you go over another window, if you start it, it enables that window. Click to front, if you double click a window, comes at the front. Context menus are the menus like that here. Cross those, you might know it from Amiga OS 3. It is a way to copy, understand and read DOS formatted floppies. Default icons, the application that manages all the different types of icons, and you have the preferences here. This one. This commodity runs all the logic, how these files are recognized and which is going to be the default, starting the default application with that file when you double click on that. For example, if you have, let me see, if you have an IFF file, what is going to do? You set it here on information. Information, yeah. On this icon, you set the default application and it uses that one. Let me remove some of the auto point, remove auto info, remove Next one is depth to front. This adds a menu here of other windows that are open, and a menu at the, if you have multiple screens open, a menu at the depth object of the workbench at the top right corner, which shows the other screens. So for the windows, if I open multiple windows here and I click the right button at this side, I can jump to another window really fast. And that's the depth to front exchange. It's an application that you have seen me using a lot, because it opens the running commodities, and you can see from here information about that commodity, the version. It opens the workbench info for the icon, so you can change something here if you want, and also remove that commodity if you want to close it. And that's exchange. Dev icons began from OS 3.5, I think, says Falcon 11. Yeah, I don't remember with 3.1 to have something like that. Livelo says, can you connect floppy on Amiga 1? I'm not going to, but just curious. Yes, of course you can do it. On Amiga 1? Probably not, if it is probably a USB floppy. But don't forget that you can use the Amiga OS 4.1, the classic version, on Amiga 1200 and Amiga 4000, right? So you might have a floppy there. Livelo says, I would never think you can. The question is why to do it, actually, because you can't read Amiga files, Amiga floppy disks, right? So what's the point to use a floppy, in my opinion? We have ADF files and we use them. The F key is, I believe, known to everybody, is one of the oldest commodities, and where you can set specific applications to start whenever you do a shortcut on your system, on your keyboard, sorry, like the one that I have at the bottom, where if I click L shift, left alt and Z, I have this application running that gives me the option to zoom on my system and show in a bigger screen some details, and also the left alt S that shows the screens, the different screens, like that. Mouse Blanker is useful commodity because when you type it, it makes the mouse pointer to disappear. No caps lock disables the caps lock, if I'm not wrong. Reaction workbench info is this window. And last but not least, the screen blanker engine, which if you run it at the boot or whenever you want to run it, it enables the screen blankers. That's what it does. And the last application that comes with Amiga OS 4.1 as a contribution is the S-Grab, which can be used to grab a screen or a window, a specific window, as a file. For example, if I select here on RAM test.jpg and select here JPEG and grab the screen, this creates a screenshot of my screen, and this is very, very nice to use. And also you can use it with shortcuts to do it on the fly whenever you want to grab something or mark something and grab it like that, and then you have a screenshot of this part of your screen. which is quite useful. There is another similar application called Snapit as well, which I think has versions for Amiga OS 3 and Amiga OS 4, which does pretty much the same thing with SGrab. And SGrab as well is available on Amiga OS 3, if I'm not wrong. Morphos has its own application that does the same thing, but I believe it SGrab is also the Amiga OS 3 version of SGrab. It runs fine on Morphos as well. So, and this is the last tool that I have on my utilities. Of course, this is not the standard ones that you might find on someone's computer, Amiga OS 4.1 installation, because people tend to copy there a lot of other applications that they like to use. In my preference is that I'm using on another partition, I use another folder named utilities, and I put there some other utilities that are useful for me. The reason for that is that I don't want to mess my installation partition with other stuff like utilities, and the other reason is that I might have many different installations, so I have only one place where I have my utilities. SGrab is very nice, Livelord, very good application. And now, I would like to start showing you how can you use Amiga OS 4.1 with internet, right? Which is something that a lot of us are using our computers nowadays to visit internet and communicate with people and watch videos, right? So I have here on my AmiDock a docky that a subdock that has some applications that I'm using a lot, but these are not only the only ones that I'm going to talk to you today. First of all, I would like to start with AWeb, which AWeb for Amiga OS 4 is a version that doesn't exist on any other Amiga OS flavor. This is updated by Andy Broad, and this version actually is able to connect to SSL websites that use the HTTPS. So, for example, if I go to Amigans, it is pretty fast as an as a browser, of course. It works fine, but of course, it doesn't have CSS support, and it doesn't have JavaScript, full JavaScript support, at least for the JavaScript that is used nowadays. But this version is quite old, unfortunately, and the browser is not maintained. So the alternative of AWeb is iBrowse, of course, 2.5.5, the latest version, I think. I hope that I didn't miss any version. Yes, 2.5.5. It's so fast. For example, if I go to os4depot.net, you just click enter and shows the page, or the Aminet. Sorry, here it is. It's quite fast. And a lot of people say, what you are going to do with this browser? For me, at least, I use it a lot, because even when I try to find something for programming, programming C, libcurl, for example, information, not, well, oh my god, programming C, libcurl, I have results pretty fast on DuckDuckGo, which I'm using as a search engine, and then I can click on something and I get rid of all these JavaScript problems that you get on websites, and you go to the actual information pretty fast. It's very fast, yeah, Falcon. Yeah, it's too bad that it doesn't support CSS. For that, we have WebKit. Sorry, WebKit. I meant NetSurf, which is also pretty fast. Let me go to search something similar, like programming C, libcurl. Like that. And you get the same results that I had previously, but with some CSS, of course. It doesn't support JavaScript. It has some support of JavaScript, but it's not that good. That's why I'm getting those errors here. And you can go here, for example, and see the page that you are looking for. SLD Snake says, I'm seeing a little lot at those download links. Yeah, possibly. Yes, I got tired of gray backgrounds. I removed the default background, the white one. Okay. SLD Snake says, Wayfarer for Amiga OS 4.1 would be nice too. Yeah, it would be nice too. And I believe that Wayfarer for OS 4, if it could use the graphics card, it would be much faster. I don't know if if it does that on Morphos, if it can use the graphics card to accelerate the environment, but because Amiga was the Amiga ones have a pretty fast and strong graphics cards, this could fly, in my honest opinion. So we have the, if you don't care about the websites that use JavaScript, those two browsers for me are perfect because they give you all the information that you need, depending on what you are looking for, of course. And yeah, if you want to go on the best forum for Amiga OS 4, it works fine on both browsers, of course, and it is pretty fast. I prefer the iBrowse on Amiga websites because it is even faster than anything else. And of course, because I created that website that I showed you some streams ago, for the iBrowse, you can visit Twitch and check for website for streamers that are doing retro stream right now, and you can select someone, let's say him, the stream, and AIO streams, the scripts that I talked to you about before, and you can have the streamer streaming on your desktop.
That's a good spot to do it in. Yeah, we have one continue again.
And also,
that just kind of works.
Right now we stream on 480p, for example. So it is pretty fine. And also, if you want to go and see, let's see if we have someone that streams Amiga or something. Let's see if Hits is streaming. Yeah, Hits is streaming. Let's view the stream. So we have Hits streaming here. Okay, and then you can use a WikiChat, which is an IRC application, and connect to Twitch, and then come here and say join hits, and you are in the chat room with hits, or go and say join Volcaro GR, my chat here, and say hello guys, and I believe that is going to appear on your screen. Otherwise, hello everyone, and you can use it to communicate on Twitch while you watch the stream.
Dane, I think it was.
Livelo says, how to change window size position of Odyssey when it opens first time? I messed around the con, but it just don't work for me. Is it possible? Yeah, Livelo, it is possible, I think. I can show you in a second where we are going to open and work with Odyssey. SLD Snake says, nice, so I could watch Volcaro GR streams on OS 4.1. Awesome, yeah, you can do that. Actually, for the to connect the Wookiee chat with the Twitch streams, you need to get one token code to do that. Let me remember. If you go to a search engine and write Twitch IRC guide, then you are going to see, let me use the NetSurf for that. There is a guide of the the first one that shows up here. You see that this guide comes from the official website of Twitch. So it's something that is totally safe to do it. And if you go scroll down here, it says to quickly get a token for your account, use this URL. And it opens a website which is twitchapps.com/TMI. Of course, that website uses a lot of JavaScript, unfortunately. So you have to do it on a browser that supports it. On Amiga OS 4.1, unfortunately, it doesn't work on any browser. So you have to do it on your PC or somewhere else, or even on your mobile. And then it gives you an alphanumeric, a big alphanumeric that starts with token colon something. All of that, you take all of that and you create a server on WikiChat. Let me show you where. Select services, servers. Yeah, you create a server on WikiChat with your Twitch username at the top and the username here, and then server name IRC chat twitch.tv, like that. And at the server password, you put the token that you got from the website of Twitch. So you have here at the top, the username should be your Twitch username. You use the irc.sat.twitch.tv as a URL for the server name. And then the server password is that token alphanumeric. And after that, when you connect, you have to join the Twitch that you want to talk to, like I did before, join hash and the name of the channel, and you are in and you can talk with them. But have in mind that see. Volcaro, GR. Yeah, I think that now I mean hello everyone on chat. When you connect with, you see on your chat that I sent that message. So it works. So whenever you send any message, I can see it here. But you don't see who participates on that chat, because Twitch doesn't send that information either. For applications that I have for Windows, the chat that I'm using on Windows, that is a Java application that does exactly that, to communicate with people on Twitch, it doesn't show you the names as soon as they start talking and start writing something on chat. So this is something that the server of Twitch does. Falcon 11 says it's a good configurate. Okay, yeah. Livelord, nice, next time. Yeah, Livelord, next time you do that and tell me how it works for you. Which app you use in iBrowse for Stream Link? What I'm using is a package of scripts that I created. You can find them on OS4Deport. They are called AIO streams. These ones. These are Python scripts which you can use on your system, and also have support YouTube and other websites, media websites. So, and when you do that, you can create a link on your settings of iBrowse. If you go to to GUI and Fab menus, you can set on a link. For example, I have here a new section, and then I have Play Twitch, and I call the specific Python scripts. And this way I can use that website AIO streams .amiga-projects.net as, let's say, a front end for those scripts. But this is working only for Twitch. So if you have, let's say, if you are looking for Amiga Bill streams, that now he's doesn't stream, but you can see here the channel videos, the previous videos of that he did from the previous streams, and you can select one, right click on your mouse, play Twitch, and this video is going to start playing on my screen. Right now this is 480p, because that's the resolution that I have as a default for my machine here. And also, if you don't want to do that from the iBrowse, you can do it with these scripts from the terminal, from the shell. Hello, Aris Amiga, welcome to the stream. So this is a good way to experience Twitch on Amiga OS 4, and to be honest, this is much faster because it doesn't use a lot of CPU process, depending of course the graphics card that you have, because with the latest drivers for Radeon, if you have Radeon Polaris, they have a video acceleration support, so all the work is done on the graphics card. Next one that I would like to show you is Odyssey. I used to open Odyssey on a separate screen. About your question, how to make the window to open on specific size, you can do it by opening the application and go to the right top corner and click that button here and click on snapshot. That saves the size of the window. Let me see if that works. And when you start it again, it opens always on that size. At the top right corner, snapshot, the menu. If you don't have that button there, you can enable that button from the Magic User Interface. If you go to Windows, here it has this button, pop-up button. If you enable this pop-up button, then you are going to have that menu, and that menu is going to be available on every Magic User Interface window. And that's the way to save it on specific size and position. And let me see. And this is, let's say, our best browser that we have right now on AmigaOS 4.1. It is called Odyssey. And let me check. It has a good support for JavaScript, but not for the latest versions of JavaScript. It has a good support for CSS, but not for the latest versions. It is based on WebKit, a version that comes from 2013, so it is 8 years old. So you understand that's a little bit problematic. But yeah, most of the websites are working pretty good. Let me see. Some are not working that well. GOG.com. Especially for the applications that manage their look and feel based on JavaScript, those are the websites that are breaking a lot. Of course, this kind of old browser is not proposed to be used, recommended to be used for web banking. If you want to do something like that, it will be better to do it from your mobile than this browser, because as I said, it's 8 years old, so it will not work that well, and it is not so trustable, right? But you can also visit YouTube with that. If you go to www.youtube.com, that's what you are going to get. It's not that useful. Okay, I think you agree with that. But if you go to myoutube.com, which is for mobile, for mobiles, then you can see a better result here. And hey, there is a good presentation for MediaVault there. And if you click on a video, let's say this one, it will start playing, and you have at the right, okay, and you have at the right the proposed. Let me try and skip that ad. And here is going to start the video. But if you go to the, let me refresh it. It has Odyssey. It uses some scripts and tries to get a better way to play the video on YouTube. So if you go to maximize, you see that right now the video plays much better. Or if this is not so visible, let me try and find another video. Let's say this one from Dan. Yes, I spent so much time trying to make it open in certain size position. Thank you so much. Thank you, Livelord. No worries at all. SLT Snake says my Firefox crashed. Maybe it's hidden methods to buy X5000. Yeah, probably. Let me see why this video doesn't work. Or let me try another one. Okay, as you can see that right now the video is a little bit juggling. Let me go with full screen and you see that it's much better, right? And I don't know if you have sound. For some reason I don't have sound, but it's working much better. Let me close that. Yes. And try a reboot because something might block the sound. Livelord says it worked after a reboot. Yeah, everything works after a good reboot. Falcon 11 says I use your latest version and it seems that's faster as previous. For the Media Vault Falcon, thank you very much for using it. Yeah, it is faster. I did a lot of fixes there. SLT Snake says that streams can use the hardware acceleration for playing video. The streams for Twitch, every stream can use the hardware acceleration based on the player that you are using. I'm using the Emotion player, and that one is using it is able to use the hardware acceleration. Yes, I think I've read that they published some update to use that kind of acceleration. You mean for the enhancer package from Aeon? There is an update, the 2.1 that was released on AmiWest a few weeks ago. And it has that acceleration libraries for video, but only for the Radeon, the Polaris graphics cards. At least for now. The Aeon update, yeah. Okay. Let me reboot. Livelord says Media Vault is awesome, using it daily now, podcast mostly. I'm glad that you like it, Livelord. Thank you very much for using it. That was my main focus for podcast support. I wanted to have that on AmigaOS 4 and there was no other application that was doing something like that. So that was one of the first goals that I wanted to succeed with this application, that I believe that it's working pretty good. And there is a big plethora of podcasts available, because I'm using an online service, and that gives a lot of information. And I don't know if you like the way that I changed the way that when you select a podcast, you get the list of the episodes that moved from the right side to the center side. I find it really intuitive, to be honest. And I can listen to the hard bass. Yeah, I told you that I will put it there. Let's see if this is going to work now. Unfortunately, YouTube does a lot of changes frequently, and all the scripts are breaking all the time. Let's refresh it. So YouTube works pretty good, but it's a little bit problematic to make it work as it should. That's why I created the AIO Streams script for supporting YouTube. For example, you can get that URL. Let me copy that and close it and go to wherever you have the AIO Streams, like that. Open a terminal and do Python YouTube-u and remove that. And this is going to start playing in the player.
Hello, Cave Dwellers. Welcome to the cave. It is, of course, no secret that I'm a big fan of the Commodore Amiga range of computers. The Amiga 500
a 720p video. Okay. And it plays quite well. And on full screen, it is pretty good. One of my plans is to create something like Media Vault, but for YouTube and for Twitch. Think about having an application for your desktop that you can go there and search for YouTube videos and click on that, and that opens the video on your media player, like the Motion, to play it. Falcon 11, yes, I have the full version of Emotion, and for me, for playing streaming videos, it is the best one. And also FFPlay plays pretty good the videos. You can use with AIO Streams, you can use whichever player you want. Libero says, wow, it is snowing outside. Really? Nice, nice. It's that cold? Is that we got deep into winter already? What else I would like to show you is AMI IRC. You can connect with IRC with using AMI IRC as well, and you can talk to fellow Amigans if you connect through the server of IRC, and you can use it to open a separate, to go and do something like that. And this version of IRC, AMI IRC, is an OS 4 native version, which was released a few years ago, but unfortunately it's not possible to be found anymore because of the known AMIRC drama, where the official developer opened the source, but there were some contributions from different developers, and some of them denied for this application to be to remain open source. So those lucky people that managed to grab the OS 4 version, they have that and use that. Otherwise, they should remain with the old Amiga OS 3 version of AMIRC, which works quite well, but it doesn't have some fixes that were needed for Amiga OS 4. Another one that I would like to show you is YAM. Falcon 11 says, what you tell about M-Player? The Falcon, sorry, the M-Player is very good for playing videos that are not coming from live streaming. The live streaming is gives you, especially from Twitch, but also from YouTube, it gives you, think about like a playlist file, similar like a playlist file like you have for Amiga Amp, that you have multiple multiple stations there, a playlist, an M3U playlist, for example, and there you, the video is broken into in many different small chunks of 5 seconds each chunk. If you feed that to FFPlay or Emotion, it plays just fine. If you feed that to M-Player, the M-Player is not capable to play that well because it stops and starts the next chunk. So you have the M-Player stops and starts all the time. And that's the way the M-Player is working. This is also happening on Linux. M-Player, it's not something that has to do with the Amiga OS. So if you want to use M-Player to play YouTube videos, it works great. If you play YouTube live streams, it doesn't work well. That's why I prefer FFPlay, because it is free of charge and you can use it and it works great. But FFPlay doesn't support currently decoding of the video on the graphics card acceleration for the video. Emotion does, and it's the preferred way to do it. Livelo says, not really, it was Coldis, but now we have first snow in Indiana, USA. Nice, nice. You are from the future, Livelo. We don't have any snow here right now. Yeah, that's the reason why Falcon 11, I don't use M-Player for streaming. Now, the YAM, the version 2.9.P1, which is the latest stable version that was released, it is native for OS 4, and it supports, it works pretty good. I have here, as you can see, on this folder I have more than 1,000 emails that are not read, so I have a lot of work to do. And let me show you, for example, if I open this email, you get some information, but as you know, YAM doesn't support HTML emails, right? So what I did to overcome that problem, I created, I'm using NetSurf for that. So if the email has an HTML, each part is an HTML. So right now I'm opening NetSurf. at that side, and I'm seeing the HTML of the email. Of course, when it has to do with responsive design on the email, NetSurf is not that good, but the result is pretty nice. For example, for this eBay, or let me see this one. If I double click here, it opens the HTML just fine, and you see the email that you got. To do that is a little bit tricky, but it works pretty good. Falcon 11 says I use Emotion Demo only. If Emotion works for you, and especially the demo, if it works for you just fine and you are happy with that, that's good. That's good. It's good that you have a demo version to try that out, right? Yeah, but yeah, I believe that the developers of Emotion deserve some support, and yeah, that's why I bought the application the first days that it was released, because they did a tremendous job there. So for the NetSurf to be able to work like that, you need to create a specific configuration file for NetSurf and align that with YAM. To do that on YAM, if you go to the configuration, there is MIME, and you have to set the HTML type. From the MIME, you can set based on the mail type what can be used. And here, let me show you. I have a viewer, the NetSurf by default, and users dir, I set a specific folder inside NetSurf, and then I give to that to the NetSurf, I feed it with the URL of the specific email. What that does is, let me show you that folder. If you go to NetSurf, in my situation, the NetSurf, when you run it, it uses the users folder, and it has a default folder here, and here is all the configuration. But if you go and run it from the shell, you can set a different folder as the user folder. That's what I did, and I created a YAM user folder, which has also a default here, and here is the configuration. So I started NetSurf with that argument. User dir is this folder, and let me try that here. NetSurf. Like that, copy, let me go here, like that. It opens always inside YAM screen at that position, at that size. So if I feed from the cell, if I feed, let me show you the full screen. If I feed the NetSurf with a specific URL, for example, https://amigans.net, it will open inside the YAM screen at that side with the that page. Of course, from the YAM, I always feed it with the URL of the email, which is a file URL, as you can see here. It's a file URL because that email is already saved on the desktop, on your machine when you receive those emails. So if I click an HTML email, I can see it and I can read it just fine on my system at the right corner, like that. or for example the eBay email, which for some reason doesn't show here that it's an HTML. There is a bug on that. You can do it from display message, all the attachment, and you can open like that. And you have inside YAML screen the email displayed like that using NetSurf, which is a very good solution for now because YAML itself doesn't support HTML emails. What else I could show you? FTP applications like the PFTP are this is one application that exists only for Amiga OS 4. It uses Reaction, and you can connect to servers and do FTP stuff, copy files, download files, etc. There is also a version of AMI FTP native for Amiga OS 4. RNO Xfer, we have seen on previous stream this application from JPV, a very nice application based on Hollywood, developed with Hollywood, and it's pretty useful, right? We have seen that for Amiga OS 3. Very good application. And others, we have seen WikiChat. Let's see my folder for the internet because I have some other interesting things here. We have seen before DigiTorrent. That's a 68K torrent client which you can use to download torrents. Unfortunately, it doesn't support torrents that use HTTPS. I hope at some point the developer is going to update it. Tweet Amiga, you remember it from the time that we were looking at that for Amiga OS 3. We have it on Amiga OS 4 as well. It's pretty fast. It shows the screens, the images pretty fast, and opens them with multi-view. Like that. And of course you can send messages on Twitter from this application just fine. You can tweet from Amiga OS 4 as well while you watch my tweet stream on Amiga OS 4. Think about it. And that's Tweet Amiga. Timberwolf is an old try to port Firefox on Amiga OS. Unfortunately, it left behind. XNet RSS is a very good application but doesn't support HTTPS sources, unfortunately. NetSpeedometer is a small utility that shows information about your connection right now and the information about it and the speed of the bytes that you send from your network is pretty much like what you have, what I have from the AmiDoc, from the docu that I showed you earlier. What else? I browse. Nui Maparium is an application that shows maps. Unfortunately, it doesn't work well with X5000. And we might crash, but it's not the first time. Let's try it. Yeah. It crashes, unfortunately. And next one, YAM Odyssey. We talked about this. SSH term. This is a terminal that gives you the ability to connect with servers, online servers, or local servers, whatever you have, Linux servers through SSH, so you can do whatever you want. It supports colors. It is very good. It supports most of the features that you will expect from an SSH connection. For example, if I try to, what else? This is going to be our talk for other time. Inews Reader, a very nice application that supports RSS. Okay, let me see here what we have. It seems that the database was broken. Let me try that now. No. Something else corrupted. Yeah. So this application is able to have a list of sources for from websites. And for example, this one, and then it gets the news from RSS news, and you can click and see and read the news, or you can also open on a browser if you want. E-news reader. Probably the previous tries that I did was with corrupted database. Basically, some tryouts that I did broke those files, but it saves some backups, and you can revert that. It's pretty nice as well if you use readers like that, RSS readers. Simple Mail, it runs pretty good on AmigaOS 4. It has an OS 4 version, but it has some compatibility, some problems with the service right now. It is long stopped for a long time. It's not maintained at all, so there is a problem with that. AFTP server, it's an application based on Hollywood, which creates an FTP server on your machine so that you can connect from another machine to exchange files. If you want to send files to your Amiga, you can use it. This is a very nice application, and it is free of charge, although because of it is Hollywood, it has some issues. Also, you can find on OS 4 Depot another server, FTP server, that is much better, and it is called Zeta FTP Server. This is a commercial application, and this is developed by Hans de Ruyter, who is also the developer of the Radeon drivers for AmigaOS 4. So, and that says to us that he is doing, because we know he's doing a tremendous job, he's a very good developer. And if you want to use FTP server with encryption and security, increased security, you can buy Zeta FTP server from his website. And on OS 4 Depot, you can find the demo version to try it for, I think, 30 days. Yeah, free 30 days trial. And if it is useful for you, it is very good to buy and support the developer. It has versions for AmigaOS 4, and recently he released the Windows version. And yes, this is pretty much the applications that I'm using to connect with internet, and the applications that I wanted to show you. I have some others here, like ClipGrab. All these are applications that use the Qt GUI And this is something that we are going to see on a future stream, where we are going to see the alternative environments that you can use on AmigaOS 4. Is there any other application that you would like to ask if it works, or you would like to see working with AmigaOS? Of course, for internet, I would say, again, MediaVault, find your favorite radio stations and listen to them, or your favorite podcasts and find the latest, for example, this one, the latest episodes and listen to that as well by clicking the play. It finds the streaming and downloads, start playing the audio on your preferred audio player. The debut like album from Bruno Mars and Anderson. One of the reasons that I wanted to create MediaVault is to prove, in a way, that we don't always need a very good browser. Of course, we can do many things from a browser, but if we focus to create applications that use online services, we can do the same things with these applications. For example, imagine about an application that might come at some point, like that, where you have at the top, like here, a search to write down what you want to watch on YouTube, and then you get in the results at a list and click on that, play, open on your media player and to watch the video. That will be cool, yeah. Wouldn't that? And of course, with Amiga Amp, you can use it also with online resources, radio stations, to listen to music. But for now, we are going to listen something locally here. So, guys, that's my stream for today. I hope you find it interesting. And I tried to share with you a lot of things that I'm doing and how you can use AmigaOS 4 with internet and do stuff there, and how I changed the way that things are working so that are convenient for me. I hope that those parts that I discussed with you are interesting, and that people are going to see how to change or make different applications work together, like the eyebrows with AIO streams and the scripts, or the YAMP with the NetSurf for the HTML emails. I hope it is interesting, and yes, that's my stream. Thank you for being here today. I would like also to thank all my supporters for helping me to bring all this content to you and to the open source applications that I'm developing. And especially I would like to thank my AmigaPal supporters, Livelord and Roman Kargin, who support me every month, and all the rest of the supporters that you can see on your screen right now. You can contact me or follow me and learn all about all the things that I'm doing on my Twitter account, which is Gisokianos. You can find me there. And also you can learn for everything that I am creating on Ko-fi / Volcero, where you can see on my blog post everything that I'm developing. I'm trying to put there all the information that I work on. And also, if you would like to support me, you can do it from that website, from the Ko-fi. And have in mind that every month, at the end of every month, 50% from the donations are donated to other projects, Amiga projects, I donate this amount of donations to other projects, so to support other developers as well. Last month we supported, me and my supporters donated to the developer of OS4Depot.net and also to JPV, who creates so many applications and supports all the Amiga flavors. Thank you everyone for being here and staying up to now. Let me see if we can raid someone to streams. Let's see who is available. Great, let's go to Amiga Live. I think he plays some pool on Amiga. Thanks everyone for being here. Have a great weekend and see you soon.